today, as Joe mentioned, I would like to talk about some subtleties which may seem or may be perceived at first sight as subtleties. And although I come here and tell you that this is a very important piece of technologies which we make multiple input of multi-user systems very efficiently. And also the receiver structures which we bring to face into such systems. So at first sight this may sound as subtleties, and I'm saying that these are very important at the heart of modern communication systems. Now the two I would like to make two key points today, and this will be the rest of the presentation, the rest of the talk is about those two points. So the first one I would like to make is that massive MIMO, that is when we deploy a large, a massive amount of antennas at base stations. That's a celebrated new technology. And that indeed solves a great number of problems. The magic of massive MIMO is that it will render interference go away. And it will also help to boost to double fold capacity. And it also has a remarkable feature, is that the hardware and the signal processing complexity we need to put in place will be much less. But I'm saying that yes, indeed, massive MIMO gives us this luxury that we can relax many of the complex algorithms which we would have with a lower number of antennas, except for the receiver design, some aspects, and except that we need to household with the resources which we spend on general state information acquisition and sending data. So massive MIMO renders many things simpler, as in lower with low number of antennas, but there are exceptions in which the opposite is true. That's my claim. So that's my point number one. My point number two is that massive MIMO is also a technology which allows us to connect a large number of devices, a large number of users at the same time. And if we deploy a large number of users, and we connect a large number of users and devices at the same time, then we will be heterogeneous, and we need distributed algorithms. We need to provide more intelligence, more autonomy, if you like, into devices, compared with how the dumb devices behave today. Okay, so massive MIMO it's important to design some algorithms, the receiver algorithms, and the pilot to data power ratio, householding the channel state information acquisition and data transmission better than the low number of antennas, and distributed algorithms are needed on the mobile stations side. It's no longer scalable, the kind of network control and every intelligence residing in the network that we have today. These are the two key points. But let me start a little bit, a step back. So the 3GPP, the third generation partnership project, is now currently standardizing something called the new radio. And this new radio is really the industrialization of what is the buzzword used to call a couple of years ago the 5G systems. So 5G systems are no longer a vision, are no longer some buzzword, no longer some papers in IEEE proceedings. It is industry standards now, or communication standards, and being deployed in many different scenarios, including enhanced mobile broadband in the interest of the operators, but also smart grids, smart buildings, industrial processes, traffic safety control in smart city situations, vehicle-to-vehicle communication, for example. So the 5G or the 3GPP new radio has no less ambition than saying that, look, let us standardize essentially a single radio interface, a single wireless technology, rather than combining Bluetooth, wireless local area networks, GSM, wideband CDMA. Let us do this in one unified technology, which gives us economy of scale. Now, in these kind of situations, it's no longer only mobile broadband services which need to be provided in an economically viable fashion, but also what we call the massive machine type communication, the large number of devices, typically cheap, low complexity devices, and also mission critical machine type communication services. So the combination of these types of services span relatively diverse set of requirements. And we are developing a technology in the research community, in the standardization community, which will meet these type of requirements. This is markedly different from what LTE or even LTE advanced systems provide today. Now, if we,
Allow the delay.
Yes. So even though I said that we are developing a single radio access technology, a single wireless interface, a single set of standards, rather than combining multiple wireless access technologies, even though it is true, but it combines multiple technology components in order to meet those diverse requirements which I mentioned just before. What are those diverse technology components? If we spend a little time on those. So multi-antenna technologies. Multi-antenna technologies, as I'm claiming today, and this is basically the topic for today's discussion, will allow higher as well as lower frequencies, will allow beamforming, by beamforming, concentrating the energy rather than spreading all over, and thereby boosting the coverage and the link budget. But it will also boost the spectral efficiency by allowing multiple users and multiple data streams to be transmitted at the same time, on the same time frequency sources. Multi-site coordination. Multi-site coordination allows user equipments, vehicles, smart devices or less smart devices to be connected to multiple sites, multiple antenna sites at different locations, and take advantage of the signal being received at multiple sites. This is sometimes also called the overlapping multipoint transmission and reception. Extension to higher frequencies. So 5G, to a large extent, is millimeter wave communication because there are a large amount of untapped available resources above the 6 gigahertz, above the 10 gigahertz, which is typically the communication bandwidth we are using today, the carrier frequencies. Indeed, the 3GPP new radio, for example, has numerology support and other solution supports up to 100 gigahertz. So we are exploiting, we are giving to the operators and the car manufacturers and the users of 5G technology which allows them to exploit bands up to 100 gigahertz. For example, the 63 gigahertz and the 71 gigahertz are standardized by in Europe to provide intelligent transportation system services. Spectrum flexibility, it means that we can more dynamically and in a lower time scale reconfigure the systems. This is called the dynamic time division duplexing systems, rather than pre-standardizing and pre-configuring exactly which time slots should be used for downlink transmission and uplink transmission. The system automatically by itself adapts according to the traffic conditions. This is one way of spectrum flexibility, and we are also researching, actually I'm coming from the ICC full duplex workshop, where we're exploring systems in which the same frequency channel at the same time can be used for transmission and reception. This was rendered basically impossible as late as 10 years ago. Now it is happening, and it is a reality. We are exploring how such technology can be integrated into cellular networks. Ultralink design. I'm going to touch upon this more during the talk. Here we are trying to minimize transmissions which are not in real time connected and needed for the user data. Today, the LTE system transmits a lot of reference signals, channel estimation signals, control channel signals, even when there is no user data. That's a waste with resources, with spectrum. So here we are talking about ultralink design, which only transmits such signals which are not directly connected to user data when on a demand basis. Access backhaul integration, so basically the borderline between base stations communicating with each other, cars communicating with each other, user equipment communicating with the base station, all of these can use the same spectrum, the same resources. All because we would like to make it more efficient, tracking efficiency, on-demand usage, or wherever the spectrum is needed, it's used and allocated there. And finally, one of my favorite topics is device-to-device communication. Whenever devices are in the proximity of each other, it is common sense that we shouldn't send the signal all the way to the tower and back. We should allow cars, smartphones, whatever devices are close in the proximity of each other, communicate directly. So this is a little bit the smorgasbord of what we call the new radio, and what we can see is happening in the context of 5G technology components. Now, in particular, if we look at the multi-antenna evolution, multi-antenna systems have been in the, at the heart of LTE ever since 2008, when the first LTE devices were standardized, and this is one of the great successes in terms of deployment in real networks. What is happening now is that we are taking it to another dimension in the sense that single-user MIMO was supported already in the early releases of LTE. Now we are talking about massive single-user MIMO allowing for a large number of streams, tens, dozens of streams to the same user or to multiple users. Remember, I'm talking about at the same time on the same frequency channel. A massive multi-layer, multi-user MIMO is when we are supporting a lot of users at the same time, each of them receiving a high number of data streams. So that means that basically we would like to separate the users in the spatial domain. A massive multi-layer MIMO is basically takes advantage of the spatial separation. So it's no longer just time and frequency and maybe code division, but also the spatial division. And this will be basically, I will talk about this particular system in the rest of the talk. And remember, my message was that the claim here is that if we have a large number of antennas, it actually simplifies, because it kind of comes with the brute force approach to many signal processing problems, and some of the beauty of the signal processing problems basically go away. Why is that? So let me be more specific on this particular issue. So here you see the number of antennas. So we are actually talking about hundreds of antennas deployed at the base station, for example. And maybe 8 or 10 or 16 antennas at the mobile station. So what happens here is that here we plot the average sum rate achievable when we increase the number of antennas. And it turns out, and there are clever algorithms, which is called the zero forcing. So zero forcing is a well-known algorithm in signal processing, and it allows to transmit the signal spatially only to the desired user and transmit nulls towards the non-desired users. What we see here, and the mesh filter is a much simpler algorithm. Mesh filter is basically doesn't care about the other users, it would just like to match the transmitted signal to the desired user's channel. It turns out that if you increase the number of antennas, the mesh filter performance in terms of every sum rate will approximate the zero forcing. So the relevance of zero forcing essentially rendered much less important in 5G systems or in the presence of large number of antennas. But there is a subtle assumption here, and that is that because even for the mesh filter, we need to know the channel.
What's the y-axis?
So the y-axis is the average sum rate.
Average?
Average sum rate.
Okay.
So that's the spectral efficiency which you can maintain in average as the channel varies.
Now the fact that there is, I mean, what you're saying is that basically you lose the advantage that zero forcing affords you because, you know, it's massive.
Yes, exactly. And what exactly is happening is that the randomly selected user's vector channel is becoming more and more orthogonal to the non-desired users. So this orthogonality comes from the, of course, it has some assumptions like uncorrelated, independently distributed random variable assumption. But the maybe more importantly is that the transmitter needs to know channel state information,
right?
Because the channel state information is critical for the performance, also for the mesh filter. We need to know what we are matching to.
Yeah. the fact that you, the difference between the two diminishes, still is a gap. A question one can ask is that within the given application context that you're talking about, is the gap still significant or not?
Right. That's indeed.
Especially below 100, because in a mobile you're going to have 0 to 60 antennas.
Yes, so there is a gap.
Below 100, the gap is not small.
Yes, there is a gap, and actually the paper by Young and Marzetta showed in 2013 that this gap does not vanish in asymptotic compression. Right. So that gap will still remain.
What happens if you reparameterize these curves as a function of the accuracy by which you know CSI?
Yes, so this is, so both curves now, so everything in this slide is the perfect CSI case.
Ah, perfect CSI.
This is the perfect CSI case, and indeed it's a very interesting question. And today, in my talk, I'm not talking about the channel state information at the transmitter side. I'm focusing on the receiver side.
Right.
But there is an analogy, there is some kind of duality between them. And we will see what happens, at least at the receiver side, when perfect channel state information is not available. Because perfect channel state information doesn't come free. We need to invest resources.
So what percentage usually of the channel bandwidth you have, you should allocate for probing to get the reasonable accuracy and the CSI?
John, please bear with me for
a couple of minutes.
And this is indeed the topic, essentially the core of my talk. So I'm really coming to that. Right, so we emphasize now the ultimate limitation.
I just want to make a comment for the people here. He is an adjunct professor in the Department of Automatic Control. He works communications. So here's the verification of what I said, that you cannot do communication networks without really good knowledge and control. And this is becoming more and more true now in these new networks, because everything is delegated to control. Right? So you need to know communication, but you need to know control and algorithms of control as well. Anyway.
So
that's not his view, it's mine, so if you want to blame anybody, blame me. Because there are communications people that anybody.
So basically, in the rest of the talk, depending on how much time I'm going to have, how can we improve the performance of the receiver in the presence of channel state information acquisition errors? So we saw the promise, basically, of the system, what happens if we have perfect channel state information. It means that a simple mesh filter will deliver us the performance of advanced systems. But the question is, John was the precursor to this, what happens if a receiver, for example one which tries to minimize the mean squared error between the transmitted and the estimated data signals, what happens then and how should we handle the non-perfect CSI case? What are the gains of channel state information error aware receivers over naive receivers? So here in this talk I am proposing a new type of receiver. And this new type of receiver, instead of combating or instead of trying by all means take advantage of perfect CSI information, I'm suggesting we develop a receiver which is CSI error aware. Because we cannot get rid of this. In practice, the channel state information error will also always be there. So it's just as good to design a receiver which is aware of it. And lose such gains, and the other one, which is not aware of, the unaware, I call it the naive receiver. And I'm asking the question, do such gains, which we would potentially gain by making the receiver aware of the errors, increase or decrease as the number of antennas grows large? So this is one of the key points I made in the beginning, that what we see in massive MIMO is that many of the complexity, because things become automatically orthogonal. But then I raise the question, if we are considering the channel state information erroneous environment, but we make the receiver CSI aware, now do such gains, which we hope to obtain in the first place, will they increase or decrease as the number of antennas goes large? Because if it turns out that it is more important than the number of antennas goes large, then we should pay increased attention to this question. We cannot dismiss it the way we did with the importance of zero forcing over mesh theater. This was actually one of the topics of the Indianapolis project, which is the early pioneer, the 5G project. So in order to approach this question, let us just briefly discuss a little bit the trade-offs involved in receiver design or in obtaining channel safety information. My first answer to John's question, you're not now quantitatively, but what are the involved trade-offs? So here what you see is time and frequency resources in an OFDM system, orthogonal frequency division multiplexing system, has chopped the resources in the time domain and the frequency domain. And these are the available symbols we have at our disposal, and we can use them for channel state information acquisition and for data transmission. So I call these the pilot subcarriers, these dark ones, and the white, or the light ones, are the data subcarriers. Those are available for data transmission. So obviously, if we increase the number of pilot symbols, and we can put them in different, according to different patterns in time and frequency, if we increase the number of these, then we will certainly will have better channel estimate. The channel estimation error will decrease because we are putting more information, more pilot information, more energy over noise and interference. Also, maybe a more subtle benefit what we obtain by this is that it allows less aggressive pilot reuse. What does that mean? That means that if I have a large number of pilot symbols, I can create long Zollner Chu sequences or long sequences for the pilot signals. Long sequences allow a larger number of users being orthogonalized in the code domain. So if I'm spanning just, let's say, just two symbols, two symbol long sequences would allow two users to be distinguished in the code domain. If I have a larger number of pilot symbols, then in neighbor cells, these symbols, the pilot sequences do not need to be reused in the same fashion as it has been just a smaller amount. Because let's say that I have just two symbols, in every cell there are two users. Then those two symbol long sequences, they must be reused in every cell. Because that's what is I have at disposal. If it is a longer, then I can use just a subset in this cell and another orthogonal subset in the other cell. So that's a very important scheme. We studied this in a recent paper. And finally, more users for multi-user multiplexing, just for the reasons I said. So in a single cell situation, forget about the multi-cell experience, in a single cell situation, the number of users which can be specially multiplexed equals to the number of orthogonal sequences. If I have long orthogonal sequences, it's a large amount of users can be supported. And that boosts spectral efficiency. But I have a tremendous price to pay, and that is that I have less data symbols available. So obviously there must be some reasonable trade-off between how many gray and how many white symbols I have. Alternatively, or in a complementary fashion, I can increase the pilot power. If I increase the pilot power, I combat the effect of the noise, because I simply increase the SNR of the pilot symbols, which will allow me better quality channel estimation. So the channel estimation error will go down. On the other hand, first of all, it leaves less energy, less power left for the data transmission, which will decrease the data transmission signal-to-noise ratio. And controversially, it can actually increase the interference on the pilot of the other cells in a multi-cell situation. So clearly, I'm not going to dwell on this more, but clearly there are very subtle trade-offs here which have a large impact on the overall system performance, both in a single cell and in a multi-cell situation, both in terms of how many pilot symbols are used and what is the pilot energy invested into channel estimation. Now, all these things are studied, these aspects are studied under the name of full dimension MIMO, full dimension or three dimension, sometimes they call it, in 3GPP. So there are technical reports, there are specifications which come up with reasonable good solutions. And so in that sense, what I'm talking about is also now getting into the domain of actual deployment, standardization, and industrialization. What I would like to address more is maybe the research aspects of this. Now I am going down, so to speak, and descending in terms of abstraction level. So let us, just to make my point, let us consider multi-user MIMO. So it means that we are serving multiple users on the same time frequency resources, only separating them in the special mode. I pick one user, I will refer to this as the tag user, user kappa. And the received signal at the base station, where I have the large number of antennas, it is a composition of all users transmitting signal. And this signal model would apply both to the data transmission and to the pilot transmission. So in simple terms, this is the large scale fading, this is the instantaneous channel fluctuation, the radio fading. This is the power used by the transmitting user, and this is the symbol transmitted by the user, and these are the, from the kappa user's perspective, the interfering users, plus noise. So the composition of this is what actually arrives at the base station. Now, it is relatively easy to prove and see, and people have been using it for decades, that if I want to create a linear estimator of the X kappa, I need a receiver at the base station side, then the optimum receiver in a somewhat arbitrary sense, which is the minimizing the squared error, but it's a fairly good measure and it has very intimate relationship with the SI and R. This is what we call the naive receiver. It is simply basically the transpose or the conjugate transpose of the channel with some proper scaling, and that will indeed minimize the squared error or the average squared error of the tag user. And so if the base station applies this receiver for all users, then the weighted MSC will indeed be minimized. This is nice. Unfortunately, this is only true, this simple structure, if the receiver knows the channel perfectly.
The ages.
If it doesn't, sorry?
If it knows the ages precisely.
If it knows the age precisely, then this structure, this what we call an IEG, indeed minimizes the least squared error of the received data symbols when perfect channel estimation is available at the receiver. As soon as this perfect channel estimation is not available, this doesn't work. So what do we do then? Well, we need to go back to the basics. Here I would actually just like to mention that this is this topic, I mean the mean squared error design and the mean squared error receiver design is still the topic of active research. So recent papers in IEEE Transactions Information Technology address this issue. But none of these papers provide the optimum receiver in the presence of channel state information errors. None of them proposes and develops methodology for channel state information error aware receiver. And this is what we attempt here. So some preliminaries. I think if you bear with me, if you run through just the notation, then the rest will be easy to grasp and hopefully will give you some insight. So what we are talking about here is this pilot signal model. Remember, this is when the transmitter and the receiver agrees upon a particular symbol, so the receiver knows what was transmitted. It can be written in this form. Again, this is the large scale fading, this is the transmit power, this is the instantaneous channel, this is the pilot sequence itself, this is a predetermined or pre-agreed sequence, and this is just the reason why this is matrix is because every symbol in a sequence of symbols at every antenna will receive thermal noise, and that's why this is conveniently written in matrix form. The estimated channel, it can take many forms. It can take itself, can be based on mean squared error estimation. But in a similar case, it's just a least squared estimate. The advantage of the least squared estimate is it doesn't need to know the covariance of the channel. If you want to do a minimum mean squared error estimation of the channel, the estimator needs to know the covariance of the channel. And that itself is a problematic sometimes. So in any case, we don't need to go into the details. We just need to grasp that the estimated channel will be the actual channel, which nature gives us, plus some error term. And the key thing is that this error term refer back to the slide in which we were discussing the trade-off between the power of the pilot and the number of the pilot signals, or the pilot sequences, symbols in the sequence. that error term, this W error term, it can be controlled by the transmitter. So if the transmitter increases the transmit power, or it increases the number of the pilot symbols, then this error term will vanish. At the expense that we don't have any more power left or any symbols left for data transmission. So obviously we cannot make it vanish in reality. But it is under the control of the transmitter. Now it turns out that the conditional channel distribution, and this will become handy and this will be useful. What is the conditional channel distribution? It means that what is the distribution of the actual channel provided that the estimated channel happens to be something. Just to help you, your thinking here, what would be the opposite? So what would be the opposite if we were asking the question, what is the distribution of the estimated channel?
Right.
If we know, or if we fix given condition that the channel happens to be something, then it would have to be the expectation of that, would have to be the, for a good estimator, it would be the actual channel, with some variance around that. It turns out that the opposite is the mean of that, around which it will fluctuate. It is not exactly the estimated channel, but it's some distorted version of the estimated channel, plus the Gaussian noise. So we can actually call this the channel estimation noise. It's not really noise, but it behaves like Gaussian noise on top of the mean, the expectation of the distorted estimated channel. So it turns out that this is useful to know what is the distribution of the actual channel given the estimated channel.
And this is instantaneous. You don't use any recursive or prior parameters.
No. So this is the instantaneous. This is based on recognizing that under certain Rayleigh fading conditions, the H and the H hat are multivariate normal,
right.
Convex vectors. And that's a useful approximation. Now, just
why people have not used the history of the sound? Drive heavily in the
I think they use it. In some cases, this is a first attempt.
This is memoryless.
This is a memoryless. So this is the instantaneous distribution given the estimate. Just to recall.
The other question is the parameters are known here. You get them, you estimate them, the D and the C and the Q.
Yeah, so that's the thing. So here I would like to elaborate a little bit. So just to recall, the R will stand for the covariance of the estimated channel. Again, this is a composition of the covariance of the actual channel. This is ideally, in a perfect world, the covariance of the estimated channel would be the same as the real channel. Unfortunately, we have an error term right here, which can be eliminated again.
Okay.
So by increasing the power and increasing the number of pilot symbols, these two covariances will fall arbitrarily close to each other at the expense of spending resources on channels. And it turns out, we don't go into the details, but these D and Q, they play a key role in the design of the what I call the MS or the CSMS error-aware receiver. What are these D and Q? So D is by definition the covariance of the actual channel, the real channel, and the inverse of the covariance of the estimated channel. So in a perfect world, this would be identity, which is intuitive because if it is identity, then this will be identity,
right.
And H given H hat will be. And in a perfect world, this would be zero, okay. Which is indeed the case.
Right.
So this is some intuition. So this is the way how we can control the error and how close the estimated channel comes to the real channel.
Excuse me, can you go back to the previous this one? Why is it that it's not tau p squared?
Right here?
Yeah.
Because I think this should be under the square of this one.
The power is the sum.
Otherwise, it was a bit of a
scrap. So, just to wrap up this part, the multi-user MIMO receiver we are looking for is now trying to minimize the expectation of the mean square error. So we are looking for a G, which would minimize. This is our estimate of the transmitted symbol. remember this Y containing all the other users' signal and the noise. And we are looking for a G, a linear receiver, with which we would just simply would like to multiply the received signal. And in such a way, of course, this will be different for all users, in such a way that the impedance distance between the estimated symbol and the actually transmitted symbol by the user should be minimized. This is our goal. So now the methodology I'm proposing is basically the following. So remember, we are looking for G kappa, for user kappa, which would minimize the mean square error, the distance between the estimated symbol and the real symbol. So how do I go about it? Obviously, the key thing to recognize is that this G, this receiver, it doesn't have access to the real symbol. That's the problem comes from in the first place. So I need a function which is only dependent on the H hat. I cannot minimize it until I have a form. So how do I achieve that? Well, if I have a function which is, if I can express the mean square error as a function of this receiver, which I'm actually looking for, and the actual channel, it's almost good enough. I'm almost there. But I need a function of the MSC which only depends on the estimated channel. Otherwise, I still can't find minimum. How do I do that? I will take the average of this expression, if I can express it, in such a over the distribution of the H given H hat. That is why it was so important that we could derive this conditional distribution. Because if you know this distribution, right, if you know a distribution, if you have a function which is a function of that distribution, you can take the average of that function over that distribution. So that is why it's important to be able to express the distribution of the actual channel condition on the estimated channel. Because then you can make this trick that we basically turn the mean square error into a function which is only dependent on the H hat. Why is that? Because G is only dependent on the H hat. And now I would like to just to mention two different approaches here. And the one is this. Let us assume that, again, we are focusing on user kappa, our tag user. The tag user's mean square error of the symbol he transmits or she transmits, it will depend on the receiver at the base station, this is what we're looking for, and of course, all the channels of all the other users, because we are in a multi-user MIMO environment, every user is affecting every other user. So we would like to, we must start from this function. Now we can play the following. Let us say that we are only interested in developing the receiver of user kappa, this tag user. We don't care about it. All the others are just interferers. In that situation, we can take the average of this mean square error and just retain the dependency of the receiver of the mean square error expression only on the tag user's channel. All the other channels' effect are averaged away. And then there's a big question. Is this right? Is this going to give us the best possible receiver? So the question, maybe on a philosophical level, or maybe on a larger interest than only or in terms in the context of multi-user MIMO receiver design, because maybe many of you will not dwell in this problem, but you may encounter other problems related in Gaussian multivariate environment, is this. Let us assume that we have somehow, by miracle, we have perfect covariance or average channel knowledge about all the other users. Of course, we don't have it yet, but let us assume for a moment. We have perfect covariance knowledge of all the other users, and we plug it into, we substitute that perfect covariance knowledge into the design of the receiver of the tag user. This is one approach. We lose information, right? We don't have any more access to the actual channel conditions of the other users because we use the average. This is approach one. Approach two, no, we don't do that. We would like to capitalize on the instantaneous estimated channel of all the other users. We don't lose information. We don't want to lose information. We want to know what is the channel which is coming and interfering the tag user. But that is not perfect. That is erroneous. So the question is, if I skip this averaging step, instead I'm trying to use the estimated channel of all the other users. Is that going to give better result or worse result? In other words, if you have just access to some uncertain variable, some random variable, only to the average, but that perfectly, or if you know, if you can estimate the instantaneous value of the random variable, but with an error, what is the better one? What is the, what gives more to our system design? Intuitively, we would say that depends on the error. I mean, if it is really off scale, then it is even misleading. On the other hand, if it is just a small error, it would should certainly give more information about the system than only the average of those random, of those same random variables. So, by this methodology, I would like to now show you some numerical results without going into too much of the details. So the results include, you could obtain a closed form expression for the MSC receiver in the presence of CSI errors when we take advantage of this averaging. So there is, I'm going to show you without much proof about the how the receiver structure itself looks like. If the receiver knows about the second order statistics in the form of this Q and D matrices. There's also a closed form expression for the mean square error itself when we use the naive, which only minimizes the mean square, the squared error, in the, if the channels are estimated perfectly, versus the MSC receiver, the true MSC receiver, which minimizes the squared error even in the presence of channel state information errors. And finally, closed form expressions for the optimal pilot data power ratio when using this particular receiver. So let us look at just the closed form, and then we'll look at numerical results. So it turns out that the optimum receiver takes advantage of this, you remember this D and Q matrices. So this D and Q matrices tells us about how far the covariance of the estimated channel goes from the covariance of the real channel, right? You remember that was the D and the Q. So the D and the Q, ideally this would go, this would tend to become the identity matrix in the perfect channel state information, and this would vanish. So it turns out that if we minimize the mean square error by the tricks I showed, which tries to express the whole MSC only as a function of the estimated channel, it turns out to become a quadratic form, and then we can obtain this minimum quite easily. So you don't even have to. So the closed form is immediately available due to the fact that it comes out in a quadratic form. We don't.
How big is K?
How big is?
How big is K? Cap K.
So K is the number of users.
No, I know, but how big is it?
So in a multi-user MIMO environment, it can easily be 10, 20. If you have hundreds of antenna, typically you have one order of magnitude lower number of users served than the number of antennas. So if you're talking about 500 antennas, then it could go up to a couple of dozens.
So there is no central limit theorem possible here?
Not yet. No. We are not having one here. Not required. So what I'm trying to say is that this is the optimal optimal receiver if we rely on the cover, if we only rely on the covariance matrices, the second order statistics of the other users, and we assume know it.
And you know it.
Yes, the receiver knows it exactly.
Right.
Alternatively, if we have, if the receiver tries to exploit all the channels instantaneous value rather than just relying on the average, we have a similar structure. But remember that these contain errors, whereas this one is known perfectly. So these are two different design approaches, and maybe applicable, or maybe in some form you will encounter in your research. So just a few results, getting close to wrap up this. So here is the pilot power. Remember I told you the pilot power is an important resource, and one dimension where we can tune this trade-off is that we increase the pilot power at the expense of having some power budget, necessarily decreasing the power available for data transmission. So here, a typical mobile station has 24 dB, 250 milliwatts as a sum power. So this, the total power available because of regulation reasons, in license, the spectrum is somewhere here. So this point is when we are spending all of the resources, or almost all the power resources. I mean, if there would be zero left for the data, then of course the least error would go to one. There's no meaningful communication with zero power. So at this end, we are spending most of the power resources on general estimation. And on this end, we don't have almost any energy for dedicated to general estimation. So here, in this regime, the channel estimate is almost gives no information about the actual channel because the error is so big. What we have on the y-axis, on the vertical axis, is the mean square error of the estimated data symbols. Right, so we are looking at uplink again, remember? The mobile station transmits a signal and the base station tries to estimate it. And this is the error. So the lower, the better. Now you see two
pairs. It's the mean square error of the symbol.
The mean square error of the symbol, right. The transmitted symbol.
This is the real test here, right?
This is the real test. That means when we really take into account both the channel estimation error, so in here, both the channel estimation error and the noise being received during data transmission are incorporated. They are the bad guys. So those are.
Where is the usual pilot power?
So the pilot power
usually that is used where
is
no, no, in the curve, where is it?
So the pilot power is here.
No, I understand, but where is the most used one power? If there is such a thing. What's the most commonly used power?
In practice.
Right.
In practice it would be the 2 sevenths. Why is that? Because we have 7 symbols in a slot. And two of them are an equal power, so it's equal power, and two of those 7 right. All of them symbols are used for channel. So it would be somewhere here.
And the low curve there is the one you have accurate information for it.
Yes. So in both cases the covariance is available for the receiver, but here the receiver is not aware. It uses the estimator as if the perfect channel estimate would be available. And then it results in a much higher mean square error than the one which is there. This is with 500 antennas. And this is with 20 antennas. So as you see, with 20 antennas, which is quite nice today in an LTE system, the gain, what I'm claiming here with all these formulas, at the end comes out quite small.
Yeah.
But if we are entering the massive MIMO regime, then the difference will be huge. Of course, the brute force always works. So
the number of antennas here is the receiver or the transmitter?
A receiver.
The,
so this
in
is
this case, is the
base station.
The base station.
The base station.
So there you can have a lot more.
Well, 500 is still.
No, no, I mean, you don't have to have 20.
No, exactly. We are moving towards 64 and 128 in 5G in the short term. So at least in standards and products, this is a different story. But what I'm trying to say here is that by increasing the number of antennas, yes, indeed, the orders of magnitude, because remember this is all scale, so by orders of magnitude, we are pushing down the MSC, but the loss or the difference, the gap between the aware receiver and the unaware receiver, the naive receiver, is getting much larger. So in that sense, it's actually much more important that we design.
So the trade-off you gain here, if I interpret your graphs correctly, is that I actually can gain in not using very high power of the pilot.
Yes, so
and achieve very good accuracy with much lower power. First, the naive receiver, right?
Yes, the interesting thing is this. Let me show you one more figure.
Yeah.
The amazing thing is this. The power which minima, this red dot indicates the minimum of that curve. Mm. So this red dot would give, this is the optimum pilot power.
Okay.
It turns out that this optimum pilot power, in the case of the optimizing receiver, doesn't depend on the number of antennas. It came as a surprise,
yeah.
And we actually couldn't prove it first. So it was just a conjecture. I tested it and it always was this. Whereas in the naive case, you have to tune the pilot power, depending on how many antennas you have, which is kind of a tedious process. In a follow-up paper, I actually proved that this is true. that the optimum, the minimum of this curve doesn't depend on the number of antennas, which is nice because you don't have to be too rich all the time when the operator increases the number of antennas at the base stations. What is maybe worthwhile pointing out is that this is the number of antennas on the horizontal axis and the minimum, the smallest possible on these curves. So in each curve I pick the minimum and then I plot that as a functional number of antennas. And as we reach higher numbers, of course, as we saw previously, this gain will increase. So this just reinforces my message that the more antennas we use and we go more and more.
Yeah, it's very big. It's almost, 10 kilos.
Yes, so that's a huge difference. Of course, you would argue that, yes, true, but the MSC of the Nani receiver also decreases radically. But you could do much better than that. And we engineers, we love to be as close to the optimum as possible. So we shouldn't lose this. Maybe if I can make just one more, just wrapping up. It's actually also very interesting that I compare these results with where would the MSC be if we would have perfect channel state information.
Yeah, true.
So by some miracle, we would have perfect channel state information. Then the MSC would be this curve. And the proposed receiver, the gap is really quite small. And this, the gap is independent of the number of antennas. So this is 100 antennas, 10 antennas, 4 antennas. So a very nice feature of this channel state information aware receiver is that it remains close to the perfect channel estimation case independent of the number of antennas. So it's always close. All right, I would like to just show one more thing and one more idea which I'd like to discuss or share with you. Today, if we look at the 3GPP standards, the standards for multi-user MIMO, they predetermine, they fix the number of pilot symbols. It is 2 OFDM symbols out of 7, which is used for channel estimation, and 5 is used for gate transmission. This is fixed. This is what I would call the fixed pilot resources. For example, that is called demodulation reference sequence, DMRS. It's in the standard. Every mobile station requires that. An alternative to that is adaptive pilot resources. And I'm convinced, this is my opinion, that we need adaptive pilot resources. For example, what happens in the vehicle communication community is that now we are densifying the pilot resources, because typically a car moves with some assumed velocity, and in that situation, it turns out that it's not enough. But I'm saying that the car sometimes slow and just hardly moves, and sometimes it moves with.
So it's clear that in the mobile connected cars environment, the channel is going to change.
The coherence
quite
time,
frequently.
Yes, the coherence time is much shorter, both in time and frequency. So we need to.
More often.
But what I'm saying is that I don't think that it's a sustainable way of thinking that, okay, we should figure out what is the typical scenario and then we standardize the pilots for that scenario. The devices themselves should be able to adapt to whatever environment they are. And so here we can use centralized algorithms. So maybe the base station or some central entity would set the optimal number of pilot resources or pilot power. But what I'm arguing is that we should go for a decentralized or maybe hybrid algorithms where the devices themselves figure out what is the best pilot data trade-off in my situation. And here many approaches can be taken. So for example, a non-cooperative game approach. Every user would like to minimize its own mean square error. You are trying to just minimize or maximize the SNR of your transmission, but you're trying to minimize the mean squared error of your own transmission. And the funny thing is that if every device does this, which we call the multi-user MIMO game. So the multi-user MIMO game, every user tries to figure out what is the best ratio for pilot and data from my own perspective. And then it will cause some errors, some disturbance, some autism memory interference, and all the others. And the others have the possibility, of course, to react to that, to respond to that. So there is this coupling. And when there is this coupling, then game theory is a very attractive and very easily applicable technique. The disadvantage is that per se doesn't automatically guarantee any kind of optimality. So we need to be careful when we use this non-cooperative game approach.
It's very Nash equilibrium.
And it turns out that if the best response is defined, for again my tag loser kappa, is that it tries, because obviously it's the MSC will depend on all the other users, but it has control over its own. And its best response is the one which actually minimizes its own discrete error. That's the best response. Because of course it will depend on all the others, but it doesn't have control over that. But it has control over its own pilot power.
Yeah, that doesn't guarantee Nash equilibrium.
That doesn't guarantee Nash equilibrium. In this particular case, though, what the amazing property of this MSC, at least I only studied this when we used this channel state information error aware receiver. It turns out that the following function, because we can say that at every round, every user has just one draw. And everybody has the opportunity to tune the pilot of the power. If everybody does that, then there will be a mapping from the original, whatever we started from, some pilot power setting for everyone. Now, after the second round, or after the first round, there will be a new setting. So in that sense, this is a mapping from P to P star. Everybody does that. And it turns out that this function is a contraction mapping. It defines a contraction mapping. And from that on, I don't even care if it's convex or not. You just know that it is a contraction mapping. And the contraction mapping possesses a fixed point characteristic. So this algorithm indeed converges to an Nash equilibrium. And maybe the last slide I show, because I promised in the beginning that I would like to make 2 points. And the one point was that some things are more important than the number of antennas increases. And also that I'm arguing that we should delegate more functionality.
How fast is convergence?
The convergence is very fast. It's two or three. Because the MSC has, nevertheless,
it has to be fast, otherwise it won't be very useful. Right?
Yes, it has to be fast, and it is fast due to the fact that the mean square error function is a function of the pilot power is actually convex.
Okay.
And yes, for that reason, two iterations for this result.
Even if it were, that's Banach's theorem, right? So the rate is determined by the derivative.
Yes, the rate is determined by the derivative. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, so in that sense, it's quite...
Right. So it's very fast, right? It's geometric.
Yes. So even though it's convex, but the derivative is quite... I mean, the slope is quite unfavorable. But even so, maybe larger systems we should study more. But in these small systems, the convergence to this... Because this is after convergence, what I'm showing now. So I'm not showing the convergence here. What I do show here is that this is a two user, so this is really a toy example. We are actually exploring it for a large number of antennas. But in a toy example case, this is the data power of user number one. Okay, so user number one can tune this data power. Remember now this is data power, so data power increases, pilot power decreases along this. So from the perspective of this user, this is the optimum setting. And this is this is parameterized, the red and the blue part, depending on how many antennas there are. So again, increasing the number of antennas is beneficial for every user. So just increase the number of antennas from 8 to 64, you immediately push down the mean square error. And the different curves in the set of the same color correspond to what the other user is doing. So the other user is increasing its energy invested into data that causes more and more interference on user number one. And remember that this is a system in which there is no pilot interference. The pilot sequences are defined such that they are orthogonal. So when the data power is increased, it is only negative. In a multi-cell situation, it becomes more complicated because in there, there is pilot contamination. So even the pilots are interfering. So it's no longer trivial whether increasing the data power is negative to the other user because it's actually decreasing the interference of the pilot. So there's a very intimate relationship between these two. But in a single cell situation, a toy example, obviously increasing the power at user 2, it will increase the error. But this can be combated by increasing the number of antennas and tuning the pilot data power. So user number 1 will jump here and find this is the Nash equilibrium point. So to wrap up this part, this second part, is that I'm saying that adaptive rather than predetermined for a large number of diverse environments type of pilot power ratio, so adaptive pilot power ratio should be used rather than fixing it because we don't know what kind of environments our systems are going to operate. And I think a game theoretic decentralized PPR setting algorithm quickly converges, and even though it may not be, it still remains to be seen whether how close it will gain come within this game to optimal. But the good thing with this is that it's non-cooperative, so it's based on data available at every user. And I think I stop here because I don't have to make my second point as well.
Thank you very much.